Our next issue then is consideration. And so once we have found there's offer and acceptance, also known as mutual assent, the question will be whether or not the court will enforce this, because we need to have a bargain for exchange under the doctrine of consideration. To constitute consideration, a performance or return promise must be bargained for. And now, we talked about bargain for, it does not necessarily mean there was a bargaining that happened, that we, you know, haggled. It's not haggling. It's that we are getting something in return. And so this very simple chart is meant to illustrate the idea that the promise is made to receive the consideration. The consideration is given to receive the promise. And so this is an exchange of value such that the parties intend to be bound by terms of this agreement. So bargain for means sought by the promisor in exchange for the promise, given by the promisee in exchange for that promise, and we have this circular or cyclical concept here with consideration being bargained for. By the way, what is it mean to bargain for performance? Performance is an act other than a promise. It includes a forbearance, a not doing something, or the creation, modification, or destruction of a legal relation. And so let's say we've been talking about selling my car for quite some time now, and you're in possession of the car. Right? You actually have the keys, you've been driving the car, and I say, are you enjoying the car? Would you like to buy it? Yes, I'd like to buy the car for $10,000. All right, so what can I do to actually effectuate that? I can then give title, right? And so there I've modified the legal relationship, I've given up the ownership of the car, and that can constitute a performance. Another thing to remember about consideration, it can flow to a third party. A third party beneficiary is a valid recipient of consideration, and so we have a case for that. We also need to remember that it doesn't matter if consideration is the only motivation for engaging in a bargain. It simply needs to be a motivation for engaging in the bargain. So the fact that what is bargained for does not itself, only by itself, induce the making of a promise does not prevent it from being consideration. Likewise, the promise does not have to be given solely to get the consideration. And so all we need is that the consideration and the promise are motive, a motive, or an inducing cause of each other. Does not have to be the sole motive or sole inducing cause on either end. All right, we saw the bargain theory play out in the case of United States versus Metters. And in short, the way this case played out, Betty Metters signed a guarantee to a loan agreement even though she didn't have to. She signed even though she didn't have to because she had gotten married to Mr. Metters, Melton Metters, after he had already secured a loan from Bargersville Bank, who was later backed by the SBA. That's how they came into the picture here. But she signed a contract even though she didn't need to, and in fact, that signature was not bargained for, and so there was not consideration because it did not induce the SBA to guarantee the loan or the original bank to lend the money. They were going to do that anyway. And since they're going to do it anyway, it was of no moment that she signed or didn't sign. And so accordingly, that was not consideration. It was not bargained for on the other side. It was gratuitous, and therefore it is not enforceable against her. We also saw in Bear v. Penotex a definition of the bargaining process. And the court has also paraphrased some of the things I've spoken about here. In this case, Bear leased some gas stations to a guy named Kemp, and Kemp then purchased a company called Webb Oil from Penotex, and now owes a bunch of money to Penotex. And in the process, is unable to meet his obligations to Bear. And so, allegedly, Penotex sends a letter to Bear saying, "We're going to help Kemp pay you." The problem is that Bear didn't offer anything in return for that, and he didn't even ask Penotex for that guarantee. They sort of offered that gratuitously. He claimed that he did not sue Kemp, which I guess would have been a problem for Penotex because of this promise, but in fact, there was no evidence that that was ever discussed, that there was ever any consideration for that promise. The promise not to sue Kemp was never made to Penotex. It was never bargained for or requested by Penotex, and therefore it did not constitute consideration for the promise, such that there was one, of Penotex to pay Kemp's bill. Meineke gets to the concept of whether a third party can receive the consideration, and yes, a third party can. Janice loaned her daughter and nephew $90,000 and secured it by a mortgage on property owned by their company. Later, the company owned by the daughter and the nephew needed more money, so they went to Northwest Bank, and Northwest Bank said, we will only give you more money if we can have priority on that loan. And so Janice had to then subordinate her rights to the loan. She signed a subordination agreement. Meineke, Northwest then provided the money to the nephew and the daughter. And she claimed that there was no consideration because she didn't receive any benefit. But we're not going to apply the benefit detriment test. We're going to look if there was a bargain for exchange. And yes, there was a bargain for exchange. Janice promised to subordinate her loan in return for the bank promising to lend money to her daughter and nephew. And although that consideration flowed to a third party and not to Janice directly, she did bargain for it, and consideration to a third party is good and valid consideration. What is not good and valid consideration, however, is nominal consideration. And in the case of Schnell versus Nell, we have a case of nominal consideration. Teresa Schnell died without owning any property in her own name, and her will, therefore, was ineffective because she had no property to bequest. But her loving husband agreed to pay the beneficiaries $200 each, one of those being Nell and other named parties in the case. So he promised to do this, and in order to make it binding, the beneficiaries had a return promise to pay the husband 1 cent. And so effectively it looked like this. Their promise was to pay $200 on the one hand, their promise to pay 1 cent on the other. Is the penny consideration? No, this was not intended to be consideration. The court sees this as a sham. This is mere nominal consideration, and so it does not count. The other thing the parties tried to raise is that the consideration that Mr. Schnell gave was the love and affection he bore his deceased wife. And this was not consideration either, because here that was not bargained for by the beneficiaries. It was not for any value received. Again, it was merely a gratuitous promise in this case. Which leads us then to our common problems with consideration. We have several, five in fact, common problems that come up in consideration. Those are conditional gifts, which we see in section 71, illusory promises, section 77, worthless settlement agreements, 74, contract modifications, 73 and 273, and discharge of duties. So I'll go through all of those. A conditional gift is an action or forbearance that is not sought in exchange. It is a mere requirement to obtain this gift. And the famous example here is Williston and the tramp. And so Williston, the famous law professor, has this example that a benevolent man sees a tramp on the corner and says, if you go to the store on the corner, you may buy a coat on my credit. Now, is going to the store going to be consideration by the tramp? And the answer is no, because the benevolent man is not looking for the tramp to take a walk, but rather is looking to give a gift. In order to get that gift, he simply has to go to the store. And so we distinguish between conditional gifts and promises supported by consideration in this way. We have a more complicated case in our gravel pit case, Tumsack versus Kuching County Highway Department. And here we have some neighbors in this community in northern Minnesota who are near a gravel pit which is filling with water. And they ask the city to help. The city says, we will furnish a pit, a pump, to pump water out of the pit if you promise to maintain it and fuel it. Now, they removed the pump at some point, and then the gravel pit proceeded to overflow and damage the property of the Tumsacks. And the Tumsacks then sued, saying this was a promise supported by consideration. The question is, was it? And the answer is no. The court found that the providing gas and fuel to the pump was simply a condition needed to get the benefit of the pump. It was not possible to provide the pump and the oil, so the city provided the pump gratuitously, and for the pump to function, they had to provide the oil. Now, this was a close case, and I think you could see reasons why a county would not want a gravel pit to overflow and flood and damage property and property values. But here the court found that there was no consideration, or at least there was not necessarily consideration for this case, and so it could not proceed at the summary judgment phase. The promise to furnish the pump, was it supported by a promise to waive liability? Was it supported by a promise to fuel the pump? We're going to have to punt that back to a jury to see whether or not that's the case. It was not necessarily the case. There's at least an open question of whether or not that was a gratuitous promise or a conditional promise. We then looked at Pennsy Supply versus American Ash Recycling. So a school district entered into a construction contract. They want to pave a road, and they're going to get this material called treated ash aggregate, or agrite, which is made out of hazardous waste. And so a company is agreeing to remove the hazardous waste on the one hand, and then to deliver it. And so the question here is whether or not the removal of hazardous waste is going to be simply a condition for getting the agrite or something more. And here the court seems to come out that it should be remanded for further proceedings because the promise to haul away the agrite was not necessarily unsupported by consideration either. American Ash had excess material. It was probably not giving that material away as a gift, but rather in return for having it hauled away. In fact, we might not even call this a good. We could call it a bad. It had negative value. So the removal of that could be consideration for the provision of it. And what's important here, as we'll see next semester, is this would create a contract for a sale of goods. Sales of goods have implied warranties of merchantability. And here, the asphalt cracked. And so the contract was very important, even though it was not for value. Now, that warranty of merchantability meant that if this was, in fact, a contract, Pennsy would have some recourse. Our next situation where we have a lack of consideration is illusory promises. These are words of promise which by their terms make the promisor's performance entirely optional. And this came up in the Questar case. In Questar, we have a contract to install flooring, and it had this cancellation clause. And so the court says, well, okay, how about the cancellation clause? Does that mean if I can cancel at any time for any reason or no reason, do we really have a contract at all? And the answer is, in short, yes, because the contract is subject to a duty of good faith. And so once we find a contract was formed, the parties have a duty of good faith to each other. You cannot cancel in bad faith. So there were some limitations on cancellation, and therefore there was, in fact, an agreement to pay on the one hand and to install carpet on the other that was not illusory. Settlement of claims is our third issue where consideration is sketchy, and this is when claims are doubtful because of uncertainty in the law, in which case the settlement of that claim will be enforceable as consideration, or if the surrendering party believes the claim to be valid even when it is not. The restatement is pretty liberal about this, and so in general, settlements are enforceable so long as either the claim is potential under the law, not necessarily a good claim, but not a total loser, or the party really believes that they have a claim. And in those cases, the settlement will be enforceable. And we have an illustration where we have we'll call him the whiny son, and he promises not to sue his dad for not giving him money. And his dad doesn't like the whiny son, and so he's giving, you know, gifts to the other children. The whiny son says, I'm going to sue you, dad, for not giving me gifts. Now, the question is whether or not the whiny son actually believes he has basis for a lawsuit. If, in fact, he knows that he can't sue his father for not giving him a gift, and he knows he has no basis for this lawsuit, then he's not going to actually have a promise. A return promise from his father is not going to be consideration for his promise not to sue. He's not really giving up anything, and he knows it. All right, in Dyer versus National Byproducts, we have a settlement because an individual lost their right leg in a job-related accident. And then there was a promise to employ Dyer, the person who lost their leg, for life in exchange for a promise not to sue for the injury. Now, as a legal matter, this claim turned out to be completely invalid, and so the question is going to be whether or not he can prevail. It is, in fact, a completely invalid claim. He had no rights to damages for this claim. Now, we have two different viewpoints, one from Corbin giving a subjective view, and Corbin says that giving up an unfounded claim counts as consideration so long as the claimant asserts it in good faith that accords with the restatement. Williston, who takes the objective view and does not accord with the restatement, said in this case, forbearance from a suit that is clearly invalid will not constitute consideration. So to whether or not Dyer will prevail in receiving this promise to be enforceable will depend on either there has to be a basis for the lawsuit, or he has to have a good faith belief that this suit is enforceable and be in a Corbin jurisdiction, not a Williston jurisdiction, which helpfully for us is a restatement jurisdiction. Okay, fourth topic is contract modification. Contracts can be modified at any time, and they do need to be supported by new consideration when they are modified. However, the restatement has loosened up on this a little bit and said that a contract can be, a promise modifying a contract is binding if the modification is fair and equitable, and or if it was provided as something that can be modified by statute. You can look at the UCC for areas that can be modified by statute. or if the modification is fair or equitable. So we see that the second restatement has made it a little easier to modify contracts than just a strict rule that says they always need consideration. So sometimes a modification without consideration is enforceable. Look at Section 89 for modification. We should be concerned about modification because of the economic concept of a holdup problem. Once the parties are already in a contractual relationship, one party can effectively hold up the other because they are in a power or a dynamic position where they have them, quote unquote, over a barrel. And we saw that in Alaska Packers. It's an image of the Alaska Packers Association. 21 seamen contracted to sail with Alaska Packers to work as fishermen. But when they arrived, they all colluded and agreed to demand double their money. And at that point, it's a short season. If you don't sail, you lose everything. And so the Alaska Packers, Domenico, who was going to manage the boat, was going to be completely out. He had no choice. He was over a barrel. They held him up. He made this modification. It was not fair and reasonable. It was not justified. It was not in good faith. And it was therefore not enforceable. All right, Angel versus Murray got into the pre-existing duty rule, and in Angel versus Murray, we had a contract for garbage collection, and this is similar to the Alaska Packers case, except there were changed circumstances. The cost of collecting this garbage increased by unforeseen circumstances, unforeseen to both parties, because the number of houses to be collected from went up dramatically, much more than was predicted. I think they predicted 20 additional homes, and instead there were 400 additional homes. So what we see here is that courts will sometimes permit the modification of a contract. They will be soft about the pre-existing duty rule pursuant to Restatement Section 89 when it's fair and reasonable. And the UCC goes even farther, and in 2209 says a contract does not need consideration to be modified. It can be modified so long as it is modified in good faith. And what does that mean? Well, fair and efficient modification. Our factors are going to look at unanticipated difficulties, voluntary agreement on both sides, and the lack of coercion. We're trying to avoid this holdup problem when you have someone over a barrel, right, and they're forced into a situation. So when the contract modification is voluntary, it will usually be enforced. And finally, and similarly, we have the concept of discharge of duty, where the obligor does not have to perform. They essentially tear up the contract. And so we saw that there are five of those forms of discharge: substitute performance, substitute contract, novation, accord and satisfaction, and rescission. Going through those briefly, so a substitute performance is one party offers a different performance from the original one. Substitute contract is an entirely different contract with the same parties. An ovation is going to be a contract that included one party will substitute a different party, a third party. A contract of rescission then would then be an agreement in the future to discharge a contract. And accord and satisfaction is the concept that a prior contract will be enforceable until the new contract is performed. And Birdsall versus Saucier came to the idea of whether or not something was a substitute performance or an accord and satisfaction. And here I think the court once again got it wrong because they did not seem to understand that there's a concept of time value of money. But effectively, a party agreed to take less money because of the concept of time value of money, although it was more upfront. And the court found that this was a substitute performance, although I think the better interpretation on that one was it was an accord and satisfaction. So briefly looking at the chart that we've put together for this, you can use this as a reference of whether or not, as you can see, consideration is required in all these cases. How we categorize it depends on what's discharged, and when those duties are discharged, and whether or not we have third parties. And so that rounds out consideration.